I think most mushroom aficionados think of polypores growing on the sides of trees. Quintessential examples would be the birch polypore, the sulfur shell, and the dryad saddle. But Albatrellus ovinus, otherwise known as the sheep polypore, is a polypore that likes to grow on the ground, particularly in the ground of deep forests, and I tend to find it in some of the most beautiful places. And it's a great deal in part because of those places that I enjoy foraging it so much. It's an excuse to get out into the remoter areas and enjoy places in the natural world of almost numinous beauty. In the places I tend to find the sheep polypore, there are the sounds of brooks flowing, little rivulets and waterfalls, the endless chirruping of songbirds, and the quiet chattering of late season woodpeckers. All these things are good enough reasons in and of themselves to get deep into the forest. But the prospect of bags full of delicious sheep polypores only makes it irresistible. They grow in the transitional time of the year, when the very first plants are starting to take on color and the very first leaves begin to fall, a time when animals lose their caution and think foremost about getting food as much as they can before winter. And while southern exposures will often feature greens of intense depth, northern exposures, especially little clefts and hillsides that don't get much sun at all, are already showing the bright hues of autumn. But in both places, in mixed, mature, and old forests, one will find the sheep polypores, often growing in little to fairly large flocks, low to the ground so one must keep an eye open to notice them, yet contrasting sharply with the paling forest colors, and growing, almost amorphous, in a wide variety of shapes. From the top, the sheep polypore is typically round dish, though often they will be wavy and sometimes have little bulges as if they are trying to start an entirely separate mushroom. As we can see in this image, where it looks like a new pileus is growing out of the larger, lower one. And in form, it presents as a stipe and pileus mushroom, that is a mushroom with a stem and a cap. But whereas many more typical stipe and pileus mushrooms have stipes that are clearly an individual part separate from the cap and can readily be broken away, the cap or pileus of Albatrellus ovinus grows directly out of the stipe. It's as if the stipe simply widens out to form the shape of a cap, and thus it cannot readily be broken away. Not only does the sheep polypore come in widely varied shape, but also widely varied size. At maturity, the cap could be as little as 4 centimeters across, or as much as 20. Here, I've placed my knife below one that I've just forged in order to show scale. The blade of the knife is about 15 centimeters, and the cap, in contrast, is about 10 centimeters. For those used to the imperial system, that's the blade is 6 inches and the cap is 4 inches. In my experience, these fungi are almost always gregarious. I have always found them growing in groups. And the groups tend to be large enough that I can fill a single bag from a group and still leave plenty of mushrooms left to go to spore. However, these fungi are known not to always grow in groups, and I have seen others find individual specimens. It may be that I find them in groups because I forage for them in undisturbed, largely pristine habitats of old forest. Notably, they are mycorrhizal with conifers, which is to say that they live in a mutual relationship with conifers, and they seem to do quite well with a wide variety of coniferous species. They are not particular. However, I find them most frequently in old forests, growing on moss and forest duff among trees that are at least a century old. The sheep polypore grows in northern Europe, as well as eastern and western North America. Genetic testing may in the future reveal these to be different species of the genus Albatrellus, and perhaps even discover that the Albatrellus that grow among one conifer species or another are in fact different species. This wouldn't at all surprise me. There are many species in the mushroom world which are almost indistinguishable under both examination by the naked eye as well as by microscope, and their difference is only revealed through genetic testing. However, if one is only aiming to forage Albatrellus, the difference hardly matters. There are almost no poisonous polypores, and I don't know of any poisonous terrestrial polypores. This particular fungus is easy to identify and has so little in the way of potential toxic lookalikes that I would consider it to be one of the safest for a new mushroomer to begin with. In old forest, I nearly always find them growing in the presence of these impressive fungi, Catathelasma ventricosum, otherwise known as the swollen-stalked cat. Like the sheep polypores, these incredibly large, impressive, and firm mushrooms are also edible. And if you like, you can learn about them at the link shown here. I don't know if these fungi simply prefer the same kind of terrain, or if they may enjoy some sort of mutually beneficial relationship, but I find them so commonly growing among one another that whenever I spot one, I immediately start looking for the other. As the swollen stalk casts grow larger and tend to maintain their noticeable white or grayish color till the end of their life cycle, they will often serve for me as flags indicating I should also be looking for sheep polypores. And it's really a win-win, because it doesn't take too many of these enormous swollen stalk cats to fill a foraging bag. And while the sheep polypores are not nearly as big, since they tend to grow in substantial clusters, it does not take long at all to fill another two or three foraging bags with them. You may find sheep polypores growing out in the open, beneath trees, upon moss and forest duff, but they have a knack for hiding too, just like real sheep. And crawling around under young coniferous saplings can often reveal a great deal. They also have a knack for pushing up against the sides of logs, as if they're seeking shelter, again like sheep. And I tend to find that the ones that you find in these more sheltered areas, that is to say, under conifer saplings, and among the leaves of logs, tend to be of better quality, a pure, more appealing white, and vermin-free. Identification of the sheep polypore is a straightforward process. Once you have ascertained that you are in the correct environment, a coniferous forest ideally of mature to old trees, with plenty of moss and duff of spruce or pine needles on the ground, in a well-watered environment, often where streams, little brooks, and springs are abundant, if the sheep polypore are present, you will first spot them, most often as what look like mushroom caps almost flat to the ground, with very little space, as little as a centimeter or less between the cap and the ground itself. Typically, the fresher the cap, the whiter it will be, but very quickly will darken to a tannish or pinkish color. If pink, it will be a pale, tannish kind of pink, not a bright, striking kind. As noted earlier, the caps will be round-ish, but often wavy, with little bulbs, as you can see here. And also, as you can see here, it can seem like a new cap is trying to divide and form on top of the cap that's presently there. Sometimes, in fact, these mushrooms will grow fused, two or more growing into one another and their flesh actually conjoined. As the caps get older, the tannish pinkish color will darken, and the caps will dry and crack. Though the cracks are not so much like fissures, they're more like pale and squiggly lines that have been engraved into the cap. They tend to burrow their stipes or stems down into the moss and duff from which they grow, which is why the caps seem to sit nearly flat on the ground. Gently pull them up and you'll reveal their stipes. The stipes may be stubby to long, anywhere from 3 to 10 centimeters, and between 1 and 4 centimeters wide. They're often stubby near the ground and taper toward the cap, though they remain stubby where the cap forms. Occasionally, if the ground is soft enough, when the fungus is pulled up, earth will be sticking to it, revealing fine root-like structures. These are not true roots, but the mycelial structure, which is the true body of the fungus. The mushroom itself, the sheep polypore, is only its fruiting body. Here is a few specimens, several sheep polypores growing together. Note the inward curled lip at the edge of the pileus. Also note the way the stipe simply spreads out to form the cap of the polypore. There's no connecting or joining point as one might see with other mushrooms. And in particular, note the pore structure of the underside of the cap. The sheep polypore is sometimes confused for mushrooms in the bolete group because it has pores under the cap, but the pores are not nearly as deep as one would see among bolete, suelis, and lexinums. In fact, the caps of the sheep polypores are quite thin, and the pore structures themselves tend to run only about 4 millimeters deep. And the pores themselves are almost microscopic at 2 to 5 per millimeter. Here is a sheep polypore in profile, a small one with a cap only about 5 centimeters in diameter. It was growing out of a steep hillside. Note how the stipe came out roughly sideways through the moss and then turned upward. Also note how thin the cap is. It's under a centimeter. With the sheep polypores, even a big one, with a cap as much as 20 centimeters in diameter, the cap will not be very thick, especially compared to other fungi, and the pore structure itself only about 4 millimeters deep. The caps, though often irregularly shaped, are more or less convex. The interior of the fungus is fairly uniform in color, white to a pale yellowish, and has little in the way of distinctive structure. There is the skin of the mushroom, the vast majority which is the inner flesh, and the very thin pore layer beneath the cap. In fact, you can see with this mushroom that the pore layer extends partly down the stipe as well. These fungi have no particular scent, and at times seem to me to smell like nothing, or at other times seem to carry a mild, typical mushroomy scent, perhaps like you would detect among the typical store-bought button mushroom, the Agaricus bisporus. They do offer a pleasant, mild mushroom flavor, and have a pleasantly dense, rubbery texture. They absorb food flavor as well and go well with almost anything you might ordinarily serve with mushrooms, making them a very versatile cooking mushroom. And for foragers, their tendency to grow in substantial clusters, and also the fact that where you find one cluster, you're likely nearby to find many more, make them excellent choices. While out foraging for these, I can typically harvest about 60 pounds in 2 hours, more than enough for my wife and I for the entire year. The sheep polypore is uncommon, and I only find them in a few select places, the best of old mature forests. As they are uncommon, if you do find them, harvest with conservation in mind. Make it a point to always leave as much as a third of a patch to go to spore. Thank you for watching. The Naturalist program is committed to the reliable coverage of natural science and environmental issues. If you like our program, please take a moment to subscribe and like.